So good evening, and thank you for coming out tonight. My name is Mark Ginto. I'm your moderator, and I want to welcome you to our first speaker series event of the year. So my day job, I'm the division head of public affairs and corporate communications for the City of Pickering. And one of my main responsibilities is the community engagement program. So make no mistake, tonight is about engaging you, the community, our residents on some very important matters that that everyone seems to be talking about these days. So this curated presentation and panel discussion is very timely as Pickering's mayor, council, and staff, we're navigating through the sweeping changes that have transformed the province's planning landscape. So for this reason, we're absolutely thrilled to have Karen Chapple, director of the School of Cities, as our feature panelist and our presenter. So just a little bit about Karen. She received her PhD from University of California, Berkeley, and was honored with the title of Professor Emerita of City and Regional Planning from Berkeley as well. So in addition to her expertise in planning and development, she's also a respected authority on urban issues. That's why she's a highly sought after interview. She's appeared on BNN Bloomberg, the Canadian Press, CTV, Fox Business, Financial Post, Toronto Star, the New York Times, and Axios, just to name a few. So we sincerely appreciate Karen coming out to Pickering to share her valuable insights with us. Following the presentation, there will be a panel discussion with our stage guests who can also share their perspectives. So at this time, I'd like to introduce members of our panel, Mayor Kevin Ash, Chair John Henry, and also the CEO of the Regional Municipality of Durham, as well as our Chief Planner, Catherine Rose. Now, and for our audience, you know, we want your participation as well too. So please stop by the entrance. There's some pen and paper. You can jot down a question and hand it to our staff over at the table. Now, before I continue, you know, it's very important that we acknowledge that the City of Pickering resides on land within the treaty and traditional territory of the Mississaugas of Scugog Island First Nation and Williams Treaty signatories of the Mississauga and Chippewa Nations. Pickering is also home to many Indigenous persons and communities who represent other diverse, distinct, and autonomous Indigenous nations. This acknowledgement reminds us of our responsibilities to our relationships with the First Peoples of Canada and to the ancestral lands on which we learn, share, work, and live. So once again, our feature panelist is Karen Chapple, Director of the School of Cities. So based out of U of T, the School of Cities is a unique interdisciplinary hub of urban research, education, and engagement, creating new and just ways for cities and their residents to thrive. So I'm personally looking forward to seeing this presentation. So without further delay, I'd like to turn it over to Karen.
Thanks so much. I'm really happy to be here. So a little bit of trivia. My family came to Durham and landed here in 1850 and lived here until about 1900. So these are my roots, where the chapels came from. So great to be back home. So let's talk a little bit about growth in Pickering and what we're seeing. What I want to start out talking about is how Pickering is growing compared to the neighboring communities. So we do a lot of data visualization at the School of Cities. And so we like to look at patterns and trends and to understand where we've been and where we're heading. So you can see Pickering here. So let me just orient you. This is 25 years of growth. So this is from 1996 to 2021 growth. And if it's blue, that means you had a lot of people, a big increase in people. If it's red, it means you lost population. And so Pickering, what stood out to me looking at this is that there's been a tremendous amount of growth actually in the rest of the region, not that much in Pickering if you put it in comparative perspective. What's going on in the rest of the region is what we call fondly tall and sprawl. So you see all that blue by the ferry, by the downtown of Toronto, across from the islands, that's the tall that we see going up in downtown Toronto, and then the sprawl you see in Brampton and going north. And then just Pickering's been kind of quiet. It hasn't quite gotten its share of growth yet. We like to look at economic indicators, and housing affordability is a crisis all over the region. So that's another thing we pulled to think about Pickering. So the darker the red, the greater the housing need, the core housing need, the people that are overcrowded or paying just too much for rent. And you can see there's a lot of dark red around. There's certainly a lot of dark red in parts of Toronto downtown. There's even dark red up in Vaughan and Markham. But Pickering is actually doing better than a lot of its neighbors. So congratulations on that. Another indicator is age. We like to look at what the demographics are just to understand, you know, what are your needs going to be in terms of schools and services? And most importantly, how are we going to be able to age in place? So the darker the color here, the higher the percent of the population that's over 65. So anything jump out here on Pickering? Pickering actually looks a bit older than its neighboring communities. So this is the first indicator that concerns me a little bit, because it's going to be hard to accommodate people throughout the life cycle. And this is something that your planning staff is thinking about a lot. They have a terrific housing strategy that talks about these issues and the need to have lots of housing options so that people of all ages can live here. Another thing we like to look at is diversity. So one of the fun maps we've been doing at the School Cities is languages. We're looking at languages and what are the concentrations of different languages across the region. And this is really hard to read from out there, but we mapped a number of different languages with more than 1,000 speakers. And they include Arabic, Urdu, Tamil, Italian, Persian, Tagalog. So you're super diverse, and you look actually a lot like the rest of the region, which is also super diverse, one of the most diverse regions in the entire world, and you're part of it. Okay, so that's what we look like in Pickering. So let's think about how we've been growing in the city. So this is a map of population density. So the darker the red, the higher the density. Patches of red mean pockets of higher density. There aren't that many pockets in Pickering, at least compared to neighboring areas where there's quite a few red patches, where there's concentrations, for instance, of transit-oriented communities. This is a map looking at how recently your development has come up. In gray are the older developments built before 2000. In red are the ones built in the last 20 years. Again, you're seeing tons of new development in places like Markham. And even east of here, Ajax and Whitby. My family came from Bowmanville and Orono, a little bit east of here. But a lot of that area has concentrations. Pickering has had a little bit less development than some of the neighbors. This is from your own website. Great map. Great. I love it when your city has a tool like this. So I just pulled this off of your website. Have anybody here played with the maps on the website? This is your development. You guys can correct me, In purple are the approved developments, and in orange are the proposals. So you can see that most of what's approved is going towards the lake, south, and most of the new stuff is actually more in the north. One of the interesting things is to look at what's the diversity of that development. So this map actually shows you what's been planned, what's the concentration across different types of housing. You can see in the purple, the ones that have been approved, that big red slice in the pie chart, that's single family. So you have a lot of single family detached that's been approved. You have a lot of proposals actually to diversify your housing options, which is actually just what your housing strategy says you need to do. So that's good news. Okay, so why do we plan? I wanna talk about two of my favorite topics. Transit-oriented development and missing middle housing, and think about it, Pickering, in light of these two very important types of development that we actually need to plan very carefully if we're going to make them happen. I actually spent 25 years in California because that's when we left Durham. We went to California for some reason. But I'm back. But one of the things I learned in California is that we make a lot of planning mistakes, and we make a lot of them around transit. And so this is a BART station that was the rapid transit in the region of the San Francisco Bay Area. On the left is a parking lot that sat there for 45 years until that new housing just came up in the last few years. A housing crisis, a housing affordability crisis, and there was a parking lot. It was a wasted opportunity. It took way too long for the city and the region to get it together to build on that parking lot. So lots of opportunity lost. Here's another example, Pleasant Hill, which is a suburb in that same region. Again, a parking lot. They have built a fabulous transit-oriented development on that parking lot now, and where they have a good mix of affordable housing and market rate housing. And then they still have their parking structure, and you can see how they've kind of they kept their parking. They have many floors of parking, and they put it. They have lots of development around it, so and it's attractively done. Not all transit-oriented development is coming out well for people, and this is a proposal over in Richmond Hill that I'm a little concerned about. There's a lot of height here, and then the question is, height is good, I mean, density is good, we need to make good use of our infrastructure, but sometimes taller buildings like this may not be affordable unless the city is requiring it in some form. And so that's been a concern and is trying to find that sweet spot of height that is very is more affordable. It kind of depends on the site. In some cases, it's actually more affordable to have taller buildings. It's complicated. It's something that we always want to think about when we plan is what are the units going to cost? I just wanted to throw this in. This is your Pickering GO station. And I read somewhere that the parking structure costs $39,000 a space to build. Luckily, the province paid for it. So the taxpayers didn't have to foot the bill. But it struck me that that's an awful lot of money to pay for a parking structure. So that's true. That's true. It comes out. Yeah. Okay, so just a couple comments on the missing middle, which we're hearing a lot about now, especially because the province is making it super easy to build up to 3 units on a lot. And so it's making us all think about how we can actually build on our own lots. At the School of Cities, we like to call this the citizen developer. So how can you become the developer of your own lot? And we kind of think this is a clue to aging in place. So we've been talking at the School of Cities about the missing little. So you might have heard about the missing middle. That's where you have sort of mid-sized development that is not commonly built anymore, but was very common 50, 60, 100 years ago. We want to add to that the missing little because we want people to think about garden suites, laneway suites, basement suites, and multiple units on a lot, and that's little, gentle, what we call gentle density. And so now we have a province which is supporting us doing that, and the question's going to be, how can we make it happen? These are the types of things that you can build with the missing middle, a different secondary suite typologies that are common. And it's really important, again, for aging in place. So this is a slide that came from a survey done in the Globe and Mail on, it was done by a company called Ipsos, but it's on where people want to live when they grow old. And that top line is the people that agree with the statement, as I get older, I will do everything I can to avoid going into a long-term care home. Okay, so, and the purple line on top is the share of people 55 and older that will do everything they can to avoid going into a long-term care home. And I'm in that group too. by the way. So a lot of people don't want to go into a long-term care home. And so we're going to have a crush of baby boomers that are aging. I'm not in that generation, but I know people that are. My big sisters are. And those baby boomers are very soon, to enter a group of folks that are challenged driving around. We took my mother's driver's license away from her a couple years ago at 85. Didn't want her to drive anymore. And so we have to think about then how we're going to make it possible if people don't want to go into long-term care homes. And we're not building many long-term care homes anymore, by the way. So what are we going to do to our cities, to our communities, to make it possible for people to stay? So this is, I think, the major challenge for communities like Pickering going forward. Okay, I'm going to give you some examples of what other cities are doing to make this all possible. And you can look on their websites. It's quite extraordinary what a few cities in British Columbia are doing to make it super easy to build the missing little, to build your garden suites and so forth. So Victoria has a set of plans that you can use. They've put in place. You can just grab the plan, submit it, and you're good to go. You can build over the counter. Kelowna did a design competition. I think this would be really great to do here. Get some designs that everybody likes. Have a contest and decide which ones you want to pre-approve, and then anybody can do it if they go by that design. That's what they're doing there. Calgary has a fabulously simple, easy to use process and website. And expedites backyard suite application reviews in 7 days. That's pretty good. So hopefully they will be getting a lot of new housing units built in those neighborhoods. So finally, I want to wrap up talking about downtown. This is what I've been thinking about a lot recently in Toronto and looking at North American downtowns, which aren't doing so well. And it's really the most rapidly changing area of our cities right now. We need to figure out what to do. This we did a study. It's at downtownrecovery.com. I bought that URL for $3. I don't know why. I guess it's nobody else cares about downtowns. But I got the URL, and now actually I'm told it's worth $3,000. So that if you go online, they give you the pricing. So anyway, but I'm not selling because it's going to be an issue for the next 10 years. So what we do is we measure downtown recovery using cell phone visits. So people that have a location activated on their phone, we track them. We have a sample of 18 million across North America. And this is a 3D visualization of it. So this is Toronto before the pandemic. This is Toronto after the pandemic hit. And this is Toronto coming back last year. So again, before the pandemic, look how prominent downtown is and the north. Pandemic hits, the north is still doing pretty well. And then post-pandemic, downtown is never quite comes back, but many of the neighborhoods around, many of the communities around are doing really well. And so I think this is a great potential for Pickering, actually, because we're seeing that a lot of folks are commuting, say, just one day a week to downtown. And then they want to live in a beautiful community like yours and send their kids to good schools and just commute that one day a week on the GO train. And so this is the big opportunity, I think, to have development around the transit station, and then also have workspaces downtown for those folks so they don't have to go downtown Toronto. So just to see, the point of the study was we compared all these different downtowns. The European ones are in yellow, the US ones are in blue, and the Canadian ones are in red, and the Canadian downtowns are really suffering. And that I can explain that, but we'll leave that for Q&A. And we did this analysis actually for different cities in in the metropolitan area looking at recovery. So we're looking at how much cell phone activity there is today compared to before the pandemic. Anything in blue has actually come back, and Pickering has come back. So glad to see that you are back where you were, anything in blue. And so you're in the light blue. You're not doing extremely well, but you're doing pretty well. If you zoom in, this is my last slide. If you zoom in on the city, on the dissemination areas, again, red are the neighborhoods that aren't doing so well, that haven't come back. They're like at half of the pandemic level of activity. Blue is the areas that are thriving. And so you see a real mix, a real patchwork. And what my hypothesis is that maybe along Kingston Road, you have some spots that haven't really come back. Maybe some of the retail's not doing quite as well as it was before. So it's quite uneven, and it gives you a lot to work on. So full employment plan for the whole staff. So I'll wrap up there.
So Karen, thanks so much. That was an educational, informative, and engaging presentation. I liked how you really grounded it in data, but you made it understandable for everyone in the audience. You gave some examples of what constitutes good and not so good planning. So, you know, I saw your fellow panelists, they're nodding their heads in agreement and following along. So I know that they want to join in on the dialogue. So I'm going to start off with some questions for you. But at first, I just want to recognize Councillor Mara Nagy, City Councillor Ward 2. Thank you. Now, first question, I'm going to direct it to each panelist, but feel free to jump in and answer if you wanted to add your own insight. So the first question is for Chair Henry. Karen touched upon much of the growth coming to Pickering and Durham region. So can you describe some of the overarching factors that are driving this level of growth?
Well, immigration is driving growth. People are choosing to make Durham their home. Durham's made up of 8 municipalities. We have growth in all 8 municipalities. I think it's the investments that that Durham region as a council has made in our university, both universities and our college, that's helped grow our young people that are now supporting the small modular nuclear reactor program in Clarington, that are working in General Motors, that are working at Kubota, that are working in the agriculture industry at Algoma Orchards, that Durham is a place where people want to move to so that they can live that life that we all thought about living when we started our families, that they want to be in communities where they can be with friends and families, and Durham is a little bit more affordable than Toronto. But we're also now being recognized. Durham was written off about 6 years ago when General Motors announced their closure. And that day, every media outlet in Canada, major media outlet, came into Oshawa. I had just finished as mayor. Mayor Carter was just starting as mayor, to talk about how Oshawa and Durham region was over, that the region was going to fall apart. And if you look at us now, we're now the energy capital of Canada, soon to be the energy capital of the world. General Motors is making vehicles again. Companies are moving out to all over the region, but in particular in Pickering, they've had great success along the Pickering Innovation Corridor. And it's about creating that environment that attracts those business out here, working through our economic development departments. You know, the best example of how we all work together was this year at the Consumer Electronics Show, when one of the best kept secrets in all of Canada was Project Arrow was launched. And that was a car that was built by the parts manufacturers and the students at Ontario Tech. And it was unveiled at the Consumer Electronics Show. And that showed the world the talent pool that we have. You can find people in your business that speak every language, have every skill set, and that makes us competitive around the world. So it's Durham's time. And I'm excited about the future. And I'm excited about the future for young people, because when was the last time you saw help wanted signs throughout the entire region?
Thank you, Chair Henry. So, you know, there's been recent announcements made with respect to the federal government and the province with in EV technology and batteries. Do you foresee some of that coming to the region?
We're there now. We've got a plan to be carbon neutral with our buses in 10 years. We've got diesel electric buses on order. They should be here shortly. 325. Yeah. So, you know, we're not only talking about it, but we're walking the walk as well. And I'm proud of that, and I'm proud of the vision that the regional councillors have going forward to take technology and adapt it. But it's also the technology related to other things. So that foghorn that went off here earlier, I just come from the Oshawa Port Authority, their annual general meeting. And when you look at the port and the ability to move goods and services out of that port, the amount of freight that can be moved on one ship and that comes off the road, the amount of product that can come from our farming community that's now being shipped around the world that now can be moved down to the Oshawa port and the difference that's going to make. So I think we're there. We're moving as fast as we can. And I'm really proud of council's approval to put a 10-year transit plan together and pass it.
Excellent. Thank you. The next question is for Mayor Ash. So the amount of growth and development applications coming in have, you know, created a great deal of concern and questions in the community. So can you articulate what you heard?
Sure. Thank you for the question. The election of last year, the biggest concern expressed to by residents was about the over intensification of our transit corridor. My friend here in the front row did a video that really changed the election in terms of discussion about Pickering, are you ready for 75 condos? And I can tell you a lot of people asked me that as I went from door to door. But the reality is we need to intensify. Since the beginning of this year, we've approved 9 buildings. Is it 9 at Pickering Town Center?
At least nine
towers, seven of which are residential, one which is office, and one hopefully will be a hotel. And that's not the old Sears wing. So we're trying to develop a downtown, and we want it to be walkable, and we want it to be connected. We want it to be transit supported. All these new residents can walk to the GO train. The doctor talked about parking. At $39,000, the condos are charging about $59,000 to $60,000, and a person buys a car for $40,000, and there's an affordability issue. They'd much rather put $100,000 in their condo than into a parking spot and a new car. So Uber's changing that, Zipcars is changing that, all that kind of stuff. I also heard during the election that people want choice in housing. They don't necessarily want to go into a condo. They want the Canadian dream, I guess, in terms of home ownership. So they want different mixes of housing. And when we looked at the map that the good doctor showed us, when we look at North Pickering, that land has been sterilized by different levels of government, both provincial and federal, for over 50 years. That's why our growth has been stagnant for so many years, is because so much of the land is owned either by the federal government or the provincial government, and they dictated the pace of development, where if private business does it, it's done at a much quicker pace. So what I heard was people do want some intensification that's transit supported, but they want it in a responsible, orderly, and sustainable way, and they wanted to do it in conjunction with the renewal of our infrastructure. They want choice in housing, anywhere from a condo to an estate lot to a single dwelling to affordable housing to townhouses. They want a mix. People often suggest that condos are not the way to go. The reality is the condos are often an entry into the marketplace for young people. It's also an exit from home ownership for seniors who want to remain in our community, don't want the burden and the cost of a home. So I'm excited about our future. We have a number of other areas in our downtown which are targeted. Tribute has the 3 towers. Macamono is going to have the Macamono site will have a tower or two as well. And that there's going to be a component of affordable housing, which Councillor Nagy is certainly a strong advocate for, as she's going through her life challenge of finding affordable housing and want to get on a mom's basement. I think your mom wants you out of the basement too, counselor. But she shares with me the challenge she has about getting an apartment and condos and having to go to bidding wards or leave a meeting because I got to go look at this condo right away. So the need is real and it's affecting people, and we need more housing supply from all realms, from a starter home, affordable home, right up to the rich people like the original chair that wants a big house. So that's what I heard.
Okay. Chair Henry, you know, those comments you heard from the mayor, was that reflected across the region, or is it kind of unique to Pickering?
No, it's reflected across the lakefront communities. Okay. In the north, it's a little bit different, mostly because the infrastructure to support some of the big development is simply not there. But, you know, if you go into Ajax particular, and their only way to build now to get to intensification is to go up, because there is no more space to build. You're seeing more buildings in Oshawa. Some are starting to move out into Clarington. But just to complement what Mayor Ash said, when it comes to transit, you know, the Pulse route in Durham takes a bus across Highway Number 2 every 7.5 minutes from Oshawa to the Scarborough, Toronto, University of Toronto Scarborough campus. But, you know, I'm the only elected chair or elected official of a large area that can say that we have transit in every part of the region of Durham now through our on-demand system. And it's an app that's available on your phone. So even the last house in the most northern part of the region of Durham has access to transit. And that is helping us also attract, because you can afford a home, but you may not be able to afford that car. And an effective transit system works that way. The same way we've got a corridor intensification on transit up the Simcoe Street corridor. And hopefully, in the not too distant future, you'll finally hear an announcement that took 30 years to get to, where the GO train finally gets to where they said it was going to go, and that will be out to Clarington.
Excellent. Okay, this next question is for Kathy, our chief planner. So Kathy, you know, with all this development and fears of increased traffic, as well as the environmental impacts, you know, how can growth be accommodated while managing these concerns?
Thanks for the question. I do know, I know the characterization of the growth that was mentioned as tall or sprawl. There is not, I think the connotation of sprawl is a negative connotation. And now we're much more orderly in planning new areas. So that's really planning for greenfield areas. So it is taking environmental or agricultural land out of the system. And we do have a very comprehensive planning approach where we do protect the natural heritage systems. Our Seton community, for example, is more than 50% natural heritage systems. So gone are the days when you pipe the creeks and then you have to daylight them 50 years later. In terms of planning, we do for roads and transportation, we do look at the traffic that would be expected. Right now I'm thinking about greenfield areas, so for example for Seton, and we're planning for the roads, the right size roads, so we don't get stuck with things like the Taunton, oh, you run it four lanes, run into the two lane steels like we do have. So we're building the roads at the size they need to be from the get-go. We're also planning for that transit to someday get to Seton. Right now, it's a terrible delay when there isn't many people living in Seton to get a bus route that is feasible. They would have the on-demand service, but it's not sort of readily available like it is along the corridor. I very much support many of the comments the mayor made and how about the importance of intensifying along the corridors that do indeed have the transit, and to give people the option to walk if they want to, or to take transit and not own a car.
Okay, thank you, Kathy. So both Karen and Kathy spoke to, you know, the notion of sprawl. So sprawl, I guess it can be described as, you know, a soulless bedroom community. So Mayor Ash, like how can Pickering avoid that fate?
I think a couple things. We need to make a complete community. And a complete community for me includes the arts. It includes recreation. both passive as well as structured. It also means that we need to connect our new greenfield developments. Pickering is about 115,000 approximately. They'd have to change the sign every day because we have new people coming in every day. But I think the sign at the Rouge says 96,000 or something, but it's quite out of date. But it's about 115,000. But it's going to grow to over 250,000. So we're going to more than double in size. We have the intensification along Kingston Road. We have Seton. The Durham official plan was just recently approved at council that expanded our urban boundaries into northeast Pickering. And as everyone knows, the government's made some early decisions about Cherrywood, and we'll be hearing more about that, I would think, in the coming months. So that big gap of area that we saw that was blank in terms of population growth is going to change. So we got to make sure that they're complete communities. We talk about 15-minute cities and 15-minute communities. Well, what it means is not that you can't go 15 minutes out of your area. What it means is we want to develop communities that have all the things you need within 15 minutes. Your doctor, a healthcare facility, your school, shopping, your rec center, your library, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you don't necessarily have to get into a car and drive to Kingston Road or whatever. So I think we have to be mindful of what we're developing and the need to have infrastructure that makes the community whole rather than getting in a car, driving to the $39,000 parking spot, getting on the GO train, going down to the city, coming back late at night, going directly home and not being part of the community. I think the other key to ending sprawl is have jobs here. People have to not only live here and play here, they got to work here. So I've always said I want to be the jobs mayor. The chair talked about some of the successes we're having along the corridor. FGF Brand's going to be 3,000 to 4,000 jobs. Kubota's head office is here. Lastman's Bad Boys head office is here. We're having tremendous success, and that's going to continue. And we're meeting with potential buyers of land along the Innovation Corridor literally on a weekly basis. So we want jobs here in Pickering as well.
Okay, thank you. Along the theme of jobs, Karen, your presentation touched upon the struggles of downtown Toronto with respect to post-pandemic recovery. Now, I know that we all want to see a vibrant and healthy downtown Toronto, but is this an opportunity for Pickering and Durham municipalities to attract economic investment here?
Oh, absolutely. I think you're going to see new employment subcenters. I think our data already shows that these are emerging, and you're seeing, again, this transformation in commuting patterns, and nobody wants to get in their car and drive 2 hours to Toronto in sub-zero temperatures. And if they work remotely, they don't have to, so they're not going to. So, I think it's a great opportunity. The one thing when I think about these jobs and these employment subcenters, the planning rule that comes to my mind is jobs housing balance. Because if you don't have the housing there for the workers, then you're just going to have a lot of car trips and people doing drive-throughs in your community. So it's going to be really important to, in these downtown areas, in these corridors of intensification, get the jobs and then get the housing then for the workers.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to go to a resident question. So, Mayor Ash, you mentioned Northeast Pickering and Vision Durham. So maybe I'm actually going to direct this question to the chair. So the responsibility of Pickering to help protect our Ajax neighbors from the downstream flooding anticipated with urban expansion into Northeast Pickering and the Carruthers headwaters. So I'm not really a question, but it's a comment. So would you be able to address that?
Well, I think the work that was done through the Toronto Conservation Authority and the report that was put together to talk about that development, and the people that work for us have this great skill set, and as they go forward in the future, they will do what they need to do to protect that natural heritage area. They're going to put plans in place that meet the needs of the community at the same time, protecting what we need to protect. So you can find that report on the Toronto Conservation website. You can read or on Pickering's website, and you can read it, and it talks about that. And, you know, Regional Council did support that financially to have it done so that we would have the information that we needed.
Okay, thank you. Since you have the mic, I do have another question for you. So social housing falls under the portfolio of the region. So outside of a huge cash injection from the province, are there any municipal policies, tools, or programs that can help with affordable housing or access to affordable housing?
You know, that's a problem that's happening across the entire country. But I'm proud to say that we looked inside the box to see if we couldn't figure out a different way to do that. And we've got some great partnerships. So the Region of Durham owns two housing corporations, the local not-for-profit housing corporation, which is a standalone organization separate from the region. It's made up of some politicians, some public members. And their partnership with Habitat for Humanity has been one that has worked out really well for us. We've had some great successes. If you go to the Normandy Street in Oshawa, it's just in behind McDonald's on Ritson Road, you'll see a project that's going on right now that I'm incredibly proud of. But you're having to think differently on how you develop affordable housing. So there's Habitat for Humanity. There is work we're doing within our local housing corporation. And then at every opportunity we can, we work with developers, and you're seeing more affordable housing come into, especially the high-rise developments that are going on. So, but the Habitat one is very unique, and it's something that can be adopted and utilized across the entire province. And I'm proud of the work that we've started to do with them, and we're continuing to do not only in Oshawa but in Clarington next.
Thank you. So Pickering recently hosted an open house, and this was for a development proposal comprised entirely of rental units with a portion dedicated to affordable housing. So I think the proposal was 41 townhouse units and around,
yeah. That's correct.
And 30% was earmarked for below market rent. So I think we can all agree that, you know, this is the kind of project that we need. We need more rental housing inventory. It's definitely a good thing. However, when the community came out, they were opposed to it. They didn't want it in their neighborhood. They thought it was going to depress housing prices. So this question is for Karen. How do you meaningfully address, you know, this type of NIMBYism while also listening to the concerns of our local community?
You say you saved the easy question for me. So, this is an issue that comes up everywhere. And one of the things that we're starting to see that is changing the conversation a little bit is when people realize that housing affordability is not just about them, it's about us. So when you start to think about your kids and your grandkids and how are they ever going to be able to live in the same community that you live in, and so, you know, having that increased consciousness is super important. Getting changing kind of the story so that we realize we're all in this together, and that housing affordability issue, that's touching the workforce, that's touching teachers. There's assistant professors at Toronto and associate professors at University of Toronto that can't get into the housing market. And so we're all in the same boat now. So understanding that, I think, is really important. I think a lot of what we need to do, though, is to be more transparent. I think there's some perception that, okay, it's 30% affordable, and that's going to go from some derelict from Toronto that's going to move up here, right, and grab that housing. But most likely it's going to come from, I don't know, a wait list in the region. And that might be somebody you know or the grandson of somebody you know. So meeting that need of that person for that affordable housing is going to keep them from taking up housing or overcrowding in housing and making communities worse somewhere else. So So that it's important to realize we're all in this.
Can I just mention one of the big issues though was parking. There wasn't enough parking. A lot of the units had no parking. So you're going to get people in there that are going to have to pay for it. Mm-hmm. They're going to have to work, and to get to work out here, they're going to have a car. So if there's not enough parking spots, a lot of those units had no parking, and that was one of the biggest issues with that development.
Kathy, do you want to address that?
Well, it's certainly something we look at with every proposal. There, I can't remember the exact ratio that they had, but one of the things, talking about transit, the ability to access transit easily, which this is not very far from Kingston Road. If you have to buy a car, then you're paying for that car and its maintenance. I forget what they say, it's somewhere around $10,000 a year to maintain your car. If they can get by living in that location without a car, then you know they're able to afford more than they could otherwise. So while I don't recall the exact percentage, I'm not sure it said that there were some units with no cars. I think it's a shared parking lot and there was a ratio. But it is one of the ways to increase affordability of the unit itself.
Yeah, thank you. Karen, you were in the Bay Area for 20 years. Were they successful in introducing these strategies?
Well, in some senses, yes. I think, one of the shocks here is, I feel like we, in this region, we often just kind of give density away to developers. And they're making an awful lot of money, some of them. And so there's an opportunity there to do what we call inclusionary zoning, to say, well, you should make some percentage of these units affordable. And when they've done that in Toronto, there is talk of that. There's a plan to have 5% be affordable in the future. But in California, you would see 25 or 30% affordable, which is a lot closer to what we kind of need. Thinking about those innovative tools, another thing that folks are doing really well in California is using public land. And we're starting to talk about this in Toronto as well. But that's our greatest asset. And often it's the transit agencies, it's the region that has surplus lands and that can be redeployed and thought about strategically.
Was it the municipality or was the state and federal government involved in that as well too?
Well, absolutely. From the state to the municipality, and they're all looking at their inventories, mm-hmm. creating these inventories of lands. Because sometimes it turns out that the province has a piece of land next to what the region has, next to what the city has, and you can put it together and work together.
Okay, thank you. It's 8:00. We started a bit late, so I'm just going to check with the panelists. Are we okay to stay a bit longer?
Sure.
You guys want to stay a bit longer as well too?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. I've got another resident question. In Pickering, we do not have any outdoor skating rinks or pools except the pool at Petticoat Creek. So I guess the question is, what are we doing about it? Are there any plans? Mirash?
Skating rinks and
pools. And outdoor pools.
Okay, well, good question. At our last council meeting, council approved $50,000 to $50,000 to do a business case review of Petticoat Creek about the city taking over some type of operation with TRCA. So that is ongoing. We're going to have a person do a review. Earlier this year, we approved or endorsed is probably a better terminology for our city center vision and the park dedication component of the condo development at the Pickering Town Center includes a large public square, which will have a water feature similar to Nathan's Phillips Square. So it'll have skating in the wintertime, and that's going to be the first phase. And I've had preliminary discussions certainly with Councillor Nagy and Councillor Cook about making some type of 365 attraction at the south end of Liverpool Road so that our businesses down there can be busy on the long weekend in July as it could be on the long weekend in October or November. And that I would envision having a skating trail or a water feature down there as well. So I acknowledge that there are needs there. We have, I think, three water parks, water play areas, I guess is a better explanation, but we need more. And Petticoat Creek is where I grew up, actually, as Craig would know. And my kids spent a lot of time over at Petticoat Creek. And it's a shame that we haven't been able to operate that. And TRCA has been just got some money from the federal government to do some renewal of the infrastructure there. And certainly the pool would be a great component. And I think city council is supportive of looking at that as an option. So I agree there is a shortcoming. We're addressing it. And I look forward to, as we're doing new builds, greenfields in the north part of our city, Seton, et cetera, we'll have more opportunities.
Sorry. One question for Karen. You focused on our aging population, Karen, and you talked about affordable and equitable, gentle urban density, or the missing middle. So Mayor Ash said that some seniors want to live in condos to downsize, but a lot of them don't. So in terms of, you know, the built form, what would you recommend what is best for seniors? And how can we see more of that here?
Yeah, I think there's a great...
Another easy one.
Yeah, another easy one, right? Yeah. Put them in the backyard. That's what, you know, so I think there's a great opportunity to build on our own lots, build in our own backyards. And there's some model programs that I've seen elsewhere in North America that I would love to see here. For instance, Monterey County, California, Habitat for Humanity has come in and done a pilot program where they take a senior housing unit, a single family home, big single family home, and they build a suite in the backyard, a garden suite. They move the senior into the garden suite, and then they manage that main house as a rental. Because if you're a senior, you don't want to become a landlord for the first time at 75 or 90, right? So an intermediary can help do that. And so these are the types of models that I think would be great to see and would make it possible for people to stay on their own property, even if it's not in the big house.
We also have... display out in the lobby tonight about our accessory dwelling. So I invite people to take a look at our new rules in regards to the accessory dwelling units, yeah, either in a house or in the backyard.
That was just announced by the province a couple months ago. Yeah. Have we received any applications yet or interest, Kathy?
Certainly following the announcement, there was quite a number of inquiries that came in. Right now, we have to actually change our official plan and zoning so that we can actually allow it. We currently now allow one additional dwelling unit, but now that you can have two additional units, we want to get our zoning up to date so that when people do come with building permit applications, they don't have a zoning issue.
Can I just mention on this point, what about the existing homeowners next door? This is all sounds great until you live in a neighborhood and the guy next door converts it into a triplex, puts somebody in the backyard, and paves his whole front lawn so all the cars can park there. And you've got a group now on the other side. Like, what about the people that already live there and like the way they live and have spent, in our cases, in Pickering, a lot of people, $1.5 million, $2 million, $2.5 million or more for their home. And now you're telling me, well, I got to have a group home on this side. I'm going to have four triplexes on the next three homes or whatever. Like, what about the existing people? Do they count too?
Well, maybe I'll try and answer it, but the good doctor can try as well. The reality is we are in a housing crisis. It's real. The chair talked about...
if someone wants a house, if they... Maybe we should go somewhere else.
I understand what you're saying. The reality is there's 500,000 new Canadians coming to our shores every year. About 300,000 stay in the GTA. We have another 500,000 temporary residents, which are typically out of country students, foreign students, who need accommodation. So, David, I understand what you're saying. The government's made a decision in regards to this. So we have to do things that would mitigate the issues that you're talking about. And some of those things are making sure there is a parking spot, because that's one of the requirements of the new accessory dwellings. Making sure that those paving issues don't impact your grading or your water flow, all those types of things. So it's those issues you raise are legitimate. But this is the new reality, and we have to be mindful that this is the way that gentle growth is going to happen in our existing neighborhoods.
Okay, thank you. Excuse me, everyone. Let's not shout out questions. It's not an ongoing debate. I do have a lot of questions from people in the audience. Just to let you know, Mayor Ash has a town hall meeting on Thursday, so you're welcome to bring some more questions and ask them whatever you want at the town hall. But I do have some more questions from people who took the time to write them down, so I'm gonna go by these. So this question is for Karen. What opportunities do you see when designing an urban core from the ground up?
Oh, well, yeah, there's fabulous opportunities, because you don't have to work with you know, toxic sites or existing landowners and structures and so forth. So there's an opportunity for the community to really think about what it wants to be and what its character is and what its character could become. And there's lots of models of really beautiful. You know, we're doing beautiful development these days. It doesn't have to be ugly. We have a lot of talent out there. A lot of them are graduating from the University of Toronto, by the way, the architecture school, and we're producing every day really, really fabulous folks. So, you know, I would urge the city to come together around a vision of some beautiful development that they'd like to see and embrace it.
Thank you. Kathy, I'm not sure if you're aware, but Kathy, our chief planner, she's also been a longtime resident of Pickering. So can you describe the challenge of switching hats, like from a resident to the chief planner? And, you know, personally, how do you want to see the city develop?
Thank you for the question. Yes, I was just reflecting on the fact that I've been here over 40 years. And when I say that out loud, it's like, oh my goodness. and I recognize a lot of people who have also been here 40 years and before I came. I have to say, I came for the job, and I loved my job. And I rented a basement apartment, and I lived there for a while. And then I rented an apartment actually just south of the office building here. And my job changed, and then I was able to afford a house, and I moved over just north of the recreation complex. So what I really loved is I could work and live in the same area. I had a mall across the street, I had a recreation complex around the corner. So just back to that idea of the 15-minute city, I'm in the 15-minute neighborhood, and I love it. I can walk to work. I have a car, and I shamefully occasionally drive to work. But when I go grocery shopping, I take my car, and I've got relatives in London and Kingston, so I travel a lot. But so I just fell in love with the city, and a really important to me was to sort of live in proximity to where I was working. So as a planner, I came, and it was, we're an area, we're growing. We had lands designated for growth. So, that was my job, to make sure that we were approving responsible developments. Again, recognizing the city doesn't develop, we review and approve developments or refuse them. So I was always trying to make it a better city, the best development we could get. I understand the concerns of residents that change is hard, whether it's more traffic, whether it's a different housing style, commercial when you didn't want commercial in the neighborhood, other people might want commercial. So I understand it's change is really hard. If we never built another house in Pickering, the traffic would still get worse, because we're a big global region, or, you know, metropolitan region. So some of those concerns are, you know, from a planner, I have to say, well, it's an acceptable impact. So again, I think about what I would like to see, and I would love to see more of that missing middle. I would love to see more bungalows or more units that are accessible, since my knees are beginning to ache as I go up and downstairs. So, I mean, I think accessible units is a real challenge. The premier's looking for 1.5 million new housing units. I don't want them to be 1.5 million three-story walk-up townhouses. You know, so there's a, you know, that's a, an area of housing that I would really like to improve on and to start pushing our developers on.
Do we have the authority to enforce a certain type of product?
Under the building code, only multiple unit, like apartment buildings, have a requirement for a minimum, I think it's 10 or 15%, I can't remember the exact percentage, of accessible units. Mm-hmm. But for the, basically the grade-related houses, single, semis, townhouses, they are not regulated under the building code. That is really the change we need. So I think that's actually something where we've got to start lobbying the Minister of Municipal Affairs to not stop meddling with the Planning Act and start working on the building code. And that's the true way to get it. I have heard some developers like Daniels are actually looking at building bungalows, often in conjunction with townhomes. But it's a challenge, but it's one I'm really wanting to take under my wing at this point.
Okay, thank you. We only have a few minutes left. We really ran over time, but do have a couple more questions. Someone was asking about, you know, there's all these people coming to Pickering and Durham region. How are you going to get more people employed? So Chair Henry, can you talk about some of the investment attraction strategies we're employing here at the region?
Well, our partnership with the eight municipalities and the Economic Development Office at the region, and how we're going outside of the region to attract businesses. I was really proud of the work that they have done at down at the Consumer Electronics Show that put us on the world stage. There is a big show in Toronto coming up where Collision, where we're there with our teams. The work that OPG is doing with small modular nuclear reactors is bringing people from around the world to look at that. There are interested parties throughout, especially Europe. We met with the president of Poland just a couple weeks ago on the impact of what is going on there to get away from Russian natural gas. So that area is an area that we're working well in. What's going on with General Motors and their change, completely changing how they do business in the Oshawa plant, is incredibly exciting. And then it's about the businesses that are choosing to move out here. Because we have that talent pool of young people that can work in these businesses. I really am excited about the future. When I was the mayor of Oshawa, my goal was always to build a community that my daughters would move back to, because that's where Kathy and I lived. Now my daughters have got careers, well, they'll never come back to Durham region, but I want to build a community where my grandkids will move to, where there's jobs and opportunities where you can make a living wage, and those times are here in Durham. I'm really proud. It doesn't matter whether you go to Oshawa or Uxbridge, you will find help wanted signs up in their industrial areas. There's a shortage of all skilled trades. There's a shortage of, at the region, we are short, have a shortage of bus drivers, police officers, paramedics, planners, engineers. This is the time for young people in school. This is a time of hope, where a few years ago, we didn't have that. And the investments that the region has made in education and in hospitals, because you can't build communities if you don't have great healthcare. So I'm proud of what council has done. I'm proud of tonight, the investments that the Port Authority is making to make sure that the port can move more tonnage out of Oshawa, because that takes more vehicles off the road, but it supports the industries that we have here. It really is a bright time for young people in our community, and I'm really excited for them.
Thank you. Karen, in your presentation, you had mentioned both Victoria and Kelowna. So Victoria has a rapid deployment affordable housing bylaw. Kelowna is trying to fast track approvals from 1 year to 3 weeks. So what's the main takeaway here? That we need to increase supply as fast as possible, or is it a bit more nuanced than that?
Oh, so these examples, to me, they're exciting because it enables the citizen developer to take action, not just to get supply on the ground as fast as possible, but rather to make it as easy as possible so that anybody, you know, somebody who's never, who's been terrified to do the kitchen renovation all these years, right? But to get that person to say, hey, I could actually carve out another suite, another unit of my house and my, you know, for my kid to come back to when they're visiting or when they need a place to live for a while. And so it's overcoming that fear of the regular homeowner of becoming a citizen developer. And so that's what I think that those rules empower. And this is why we've seen in places that have done this right, and California now has 20% of its new units coming from suites. 20%, one out of every five comes from suites because they've made it so easy for people to do it yourself.
Hey, thank you. So folks, you know, that comes to the end of our presentation and discussion. So I do want to thank you all for attending and participating. Thank you to Karen Chapple, our future presenter and panelists. And as well, thank you to Mayor Ash, Chair Henry, and Kathy Rose, our Chief Planner.